take time out with God again here at Cafe Church, and I hope you've all got your cuppy. Let's acknowledge that we can worship at any time, right where we are, as we start by singing, "Come, now is the time to worship." To step into the psalm on Sunday and have a little look about this whole issue of prayer. And we have seen how important prayer was in the life of Paul with his conversion. So what I thought I would do is just dig in a little bit deeper to the passage that we had a week past Sunday when we talked of the conversion of Paul and the difference that it made in his life. So to remind us, let's just hear that little passage again.
Acts 9, verses 19b to 31. Saul stayed for a few days with the believers in Damascus. He went straight to the synagogues and began to preach that Jesus was the Son of God. All who heard him were amazed and asked, "Isn't he the one who in Jerusalem was killing those who worshipped that man Jesus? And didn't he come here for the very purpose of arresting those people and taking them back to the chief priests?" But Saul's preaching became even more powerful, and his proofs that Jesus was the Messiah were so convincing that the Jews who lived in Damascus could not answer him. After many days had gone by, the Jews met together and made plans to kill Saul, but he was told of their plan. Day and night they watched the city gates in order to kill him. But one night, Saul's followers took him and led him down through an opening in the wall, lowering him in a basket. Saul went to Jerusalem and tried to join the disciples, but they would not believe that he was a disciple, and they were all afraid of him. Then Barnabas came to his help and took him to the apostles. He explained to them how Saul had seen the Lord on the road and that the Lord had spoken to him. He also told them how boldly Saul had preached in the name of Jesus in Damascus. And so Saul stayed with them and went all over Jerusalem, preaching boldly in the name of the Lord. He also talked and disputed with the Greek-speaking Jews, but they tried to kill him. When the believers found out about this, they took Saul to Caesarea and sent him away to Tarsus. And so it was that the church throughout Judea, Galilee and Samaria had a time of peace. Through the help of the Holy Spirit, it was strengthened and grew in numbers as it lived in reverence for the Lord. Amen.
We have seen over the weeks, over the many weeks since we were in lockdown and coming out, how important prayer has been to the followers of Jesus. We saw it, in fact, with Jesus himself and the time that he spent talking to God and the way that he cried out to God and the time that he gave to being in God's presence. And he taught this same attitude to his disciples. He taught them how to pray and he prayed for them. We also saw the importance, we've seen the importance of prayer to the early church, the disciples that are trying to build God's kingdom and relying on the power of the Holy Spirit, the time that they spent in prayer, and those early believers, the time that they too spent in prayer, all the way through to this, what we call the conversion of Saul, becomes Paul, but he spends those 3 days when he's blind and he spends those days in prayer. And I would imagine that those 3 days would have taught him so much more about prayer than at any other time in his life. And I wanted to just pick up too on a wee bitty that we saw in the psalm on Sunday when we looked at Psalm 139, the psalmist who is crying out to God, speaking to God, and he also throws in that little line that, oh Lord, there are so many of your words and I find your words so tough. And so what I want to do tonight is pick up, go back to where we were when we were looking at Paul, and look at this whole thing about the difference that the prayer has made, even to his interpretation of scripture. And to do that, I need to look at the very first part of the passage that we read tonight. When we hear of Paul going to preach in the synagogue, so this is after his vision of the Lord Jesus Christ, when he gets his sight back, after a few days, straight off to the synagogue, and he starts to preach. Remember what I've been saying for many weeks now, that he is good. He has a good understanding of scripture because he was taught well and he was a very, very good practicing Jew. But here he is now with a different interpretation of scripture. And I would imagine that during those 3 days in prayer, God has helped him, the Holy Spirit has helped him to join up dots and make connections. Because if we look at verse 20, he's making a massive proclamation because he's not just saying that Jesus is the Messiah, but that Jesus is the Son of God. Now, not only is that a huge turnaround in the position that Paul used to take and where he used to come from, but it's also a hugely antagonistic thing to say in a synagogue where they would find that as blasphemous, because now he's not just saying Jesus is Messiah, he's saying that Jesus, the Messiah, is also the Son of God. So what's this all about? Why is this such a big thing? And what has led Paul to join those dots? We need to understand that the Messiah is a person, a being that the Jews have been waiting for centuries. It goes back to the Old Testament prophets, where God promises to send someone who's going to put things right in the relationship that is between God and his people. And no one is quite sure who this Messiah is going to be. There's descriptions, there's little nuggets there in the Old Testament prophets, but nobody's sure. So you have different schools of thought in at that time, in their day. Some were waiting for a man who would be a king like David, especially in the times that Paul was living in when they were dominated by the Roman Empire. So this would be a king. David was a mighty warrior, so they're looking for a Messiah, a king who would come and free them up from the Romans, and then they could be their own people and worship God the way that they want to. Although it has to be said that if we look at their history, even when they weren't being dominated by another nation, they weren't always that good at worshipping God in the way that they should. Others, though, thought that this might be some kind of spiritual being, some kind of heavenly angel that would come and, guess what, release them from the power of the Romans so that they could live the way that they wanted to. So whoever or whatever they thought the Messiah was, end result was the same. It was a very kind of practical warrior type stance of, you know, this is where we are right now in our society and this is what's happening to us, and we're being dominated by a different empire, and we need God's person. The person who Isaiah calls the suffering servant to come. It's amazing that during this turnaround that the Apostle Paul has done, he has now joined the dots, and he is equating the suffering servant with the life and the suffering of the Lord Jesus Christ. He's made that connection. He gets it now. This is the one. This is the one that we've been waiting for. He fits the bill. Folks, can I tell you, he's the only one who fits the bill and ticks all those ticks for the things that the prophet said about this person who would come, the one who would come, God's chosen one, the Messiah. So the Apostle Paul has made that connection now, and he's now standing there in the synagogues saying, Jesus is the one, God's chosen one, the suffering servant, the Messiah. But he's going even further now. Now, this is the man who was holding the coats when Stephen was stoned. The disciples, yes, believed that Jesus was the Messiah. You hear this coming out in conversation when the disciples are with Jesus, and Jesus says, who do people say I am? And then he asks them the question, who do you say I am? And it's Peter is the one who first says, you're the Messiah, you're the one that we've been waiting for, you're definitely him. You need to understand, in the society in which they lived, there'd been an awful lot of would-be messiahs come and go. And this time they say, no, you're definitely the Messiah. And the early believers have the sense that not only is Jesus the Messiah, but there's something more, something deeper. It's there in what Stephen is saying. We didn't actually look at the words that Stephen said before he was stoned. He kind of goes back through history. Remember what he's accused of. He's accused of disrespecting Moses and the law and disrespecting the temple. In actual fact, what he's doing is, you know, he's interpreting scripture in the way that Jesus would have interpreted scripture, and putting the temple and the law in a different, seeing it in a different way. And that's what has angered them so much. This is what he's being tried for. But even Stephen makes that connection, but it's not quite so explicit, because Stephen refers to Jesus, the one who they have crucified, as the suffering servant. So Stephen is connecting the dots as well. But he's not standing there in front of them saying Jesus is the Son of God in the way that Paul is boldly, brazenly standing saying. And what Paul has done is he's gone even further. His knowledge of the prophet Isaiah would have been tremendous. So he's not just referring to him as a suffering servant, he's not just referring to him as the Messiah, but he's joining the dots. And this little verse that's going to come up here on the screen just now, well, you'll see what I mean. He's joining the dots and saying that the Messiah, Jesus, is also the one that Isaiah is referring to when he talks about Wonderful Counselor, Almighty God, the one that he's talking about when he talks about the Son of God. This is what will have incensed the Jews so much that Paul has to get out of there. But I need to say to you, for Paul to join these dots in that way, it must have been during that time when he has been crying out to God in prayer. The Holy Spirit has, you know, talked about the passage, talked about the scales falling from his eyes, but the Holy Spirit has revealed to him, if you like, given him this revelation of what Scripture means, who Jesus is, and you know what, the proof is there in the Scriptures that you know so well. I remember a very lovely, godly man when I was struggling with something, and I'm saying, you know, I need God to give me some kind of explanation, once saying to me in a lovely, gentle way, you know, God very, very seldom gives explanation, but he very often gives revelation. And at the time that we've been through, I guess as many times people have said, oh, dear me, what's this all about? What's this all about? Can I ask you to spend that little bit of time in prayer where you're coming before God and saying, Lord, just show me in your way and in your time. Reveal to me the secrets of Scripture that I haven't seen before, that help me to understand these difficult words that the psalmist struggled with, that the Apostle Paul knew so well but is now connecting the dots in a different way. Help me too to connect those dots. It's not going to stop there for Paul, because Paul is still going to be this godly man with godly understanding. And what I want to say, just as we kind of come to an end of this tonight, is to pick up that last little bit of passage and to explain that we need to understand that Luke's gospel gives us, Luke's account in Acts, because we believe that Luke also wrote Acts, gives us a great account of what was happening in those days of the early church with the believers and the disciples. However, you have to understand it's not a dear diary. So it's not saying this happened on this day, and this happened the next day, and this happened the next day. And there are those in the scholarship, in biblical scholarship, that would refer to this period of the Apostle Paul's life from when he is converted and has a complete turnaround and starts to minister himself and writes his letters to the different churches. There are those who call it kind of the tunnel years, because they're trying to piece together what happened and in what order did it happen in, and that's kind of hard to do. But it can be guessed at by looking at what Paul tells us himself in some of his letters. So there's the next little bit that talks about Paul, Saul, going into Jerusalem. Probably didn't happen straight away. And I'm going to say, justify why I'm saying that. And to do that, I don't intend you to have a look just now, but you can have a look. If you go to the letter that Paul wrote to the church, to the Galatians, it's a bit of a snippy letter, it has to be said, and someday we'll maybe look at that. But even in that very first chapter there, what Paul is doing is he's saying to them, this is what happened. And he talks about his conversion. He talks about going to the synagogue and having to get out of Damascus. Okay, now we've already seen that. That's in Acts. However, he says when he leaves Damascus, what he does is he clears off to Arabia. And he spends some time in Arabia for 3 years. For 3 years. We don't know what he was doing. Many scholars have suggested that maybe he went to Mount Sinai. And why not? Because let's face it, Moses went there to take time out with God. Elijah goes there to take time out with God. So why wouldn't someone called Paul, who's had this amazing experience, this amazing encounter with the Lord Jesus Christ, go to the place where these other big, big biblical greats have gone to take time out with God? Whatever he does for those 3 years, he's taking time out, and I would imagine that God is teaching him through his prayer, through his and enabling his understanding, getting him ready for the ministry and the mission that lies ahead for him. Because Paul tells us himself that it's some 3 years later that he heads into Jerusalem. So that last little bit that we pick up on there about Paul going into Jerusalem, and then guess what, getting into bother in Jerusalem, because again the Jewish authorities in Jerusalem decide that they want to get rid of him, and then he has to clear off again, off to Tarsus. It would appear that he had this time out, this 3 years out, before that happened. But it's quite nice to be able to look to these other passages to try to give us that little bit of context. And you know what? I would imagine that as Paul has then gone off to Tarsus, to a place of safety, it's going back to the beginning. It'll be another time where he prays fervently to God and allows God to direct his paths. We're here, you know, I've said many times, we're on a cusp, we're not back in the building yet. Oh, can I also reassure all of those of you who have been watching online, we will be continuing online. Please don't just switch off your computer or whatever it is you watch us on. Please still meet with us online as well. We will be continuing services online as well. So please meet up with us here. You know, we're probably at that bit where we're like Paul, going back to the beginning. If ever we needed to pray, and if we've not got our prayer life sorted out by now, let's work on it. Let's work on it. Let's take that time out. Let's get God, allow God to speak to us, to enable us to understand his words, and to take us to a new place in our relationship with him. And as Christians, as he leads us forward, as we have to rediscover church and being church all over again. It's almost like Paul going back to the beginning and the early church starting to do things in a different way and moving into the unknown. God saw them through. He'll see us through as well. So let's talk to the Lord right now. Let us pray. Loving Lord, even when we try to live for you, we can get it so wrong. Lord, many times we need you to turn our lives round in exactly the same way as you did for the Apostle Paul, who lived fervently for you until he had an encounter, a close-up encounter with the Lord Jesus Christ. And after that encounter, your spirit completely changed his ways and his opinions as he engaged with your word in a different way, in a new way. Lord, we ask that you would help us to engage in your way. We thank you for those who have gone before. But Lord, we thank you most of all for the Lord Jesus Christ and for the gift of your spirit, who teaches us, who speaks right into our very souls, that as we come to engage with your word, you show us your way. Lord, help us more and more to understand the ways of the Lord Jesus Christ, his love, his grace, his mercy, as we try to live for you and be your people. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to close tonight with a beautiful little song. It acknowledges who Jesus is, including Son of God. It's a little song that starts off, Jesus, what a beautiful name. You might not have heard it before. The good thing about watching online is you can always run it back and join in when you've picked up the tune.
Jesus, what a beautiful name.
So now may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you evermore. Amen.